Hello and welcome to this tutorial. My name is Pat Trimby. I'm the EBSD Product Manager here at Oxford Instruments Nanoanalysis. And in the next 20-25 minutes or so, I'm going to be demonstrating effective EBSD data processing using our software AZtecCrystal. So following this slide, I'm going to be switching over to a live software demonstration, and I'm going to be covering a lot of different topics in the next 20 minutes. Specifically, how we can evaluate and clean EBSD data, looking at grain size analyses, how we can partition our data into subsets for specific analyses, some of the issues of looking at textures and crystallographic preferred orientations, looking at how we can use boundary disorientations to understand processes in our microstructure, and then I'll be looking at some new features such as how we can reconstruct parent grain microstructures and how we can determine elastic properties from EBSD data. There should be a little bit of time at the end, maybe 4 or 5 minutes, for questions and answers. So with that, let's crack on to the demonstration. So we start off here with the opening screen of our software AZtecCrystal, and you can see we can graphically visualize the recently opened data, and we have a second tab that shows demonstration data, which is extensively used in our help files. I'm going to start by opening a geological data set. This is a quartz rock. It's about 5 million EBSD analysis points, and it's a partially recrystallized shear zone. Now, when we open up data for the first time in AZtecCrystal, it will calculate an orientation map, such as what we're showing here. It will also calculate a phase map. And we can immediately evaluate the microstructure. And we see on the left-hand side basic information about this particular data set. So the hit rate, about 97.5%, the step size, 750 nanometers. And we can see the phase information. So this is high trigonal quartz that has been used for indexing in this particular data set. So the first thing we typically want to do is to check how much cleaning of the data we need to undertake. And part of that is to assess whether the data have been distorted, if there's been significant drift during the analysis. And in our new version of AZtecCrystal, we have a distortion correction tool. And so what's good is to go and look at the electron image. So here, this is a montage of individual force scatter images. And then we can change the transparency, and we can see very clearly here that the positions of the features in our EBSD map actually match very nicely with the positions within the overall force scatter image. So there's no distortion correction that we need to undertake in this particular data set. I will show quickly later on how we can correct a distorted data set. So then we need to look at the quality of the indexing. And this is something you should always undertake when looking at EBSD data. There will invariably be points that haven't been indexed, often lying along grain boundaries or where there's dirt particles. But there will also, for example, in this particular data set, be small points or clusters of points that look to have the wrong orientation. And we can see in this pink colored grain here, the purple colored grain, that there are little points, and they have a specific relationship to the host grain, in this case 60 degrees around the c-axis. And this is what we call the pseudo-symmetric indexing error. So we can take that orientation relationship and we can add that into our data cleanup library. But we can also see that there's other boundaries, and I highlighted one there on the top right, which also have this relationship. And here's another one in the orange grain. So there's a complication in this data set that we have twin boundaries with this 60 degrees around c-axis orientation relationship, but we also have misindexing. And when we plot those boundaries onto the map and color them in red, you can see many of the grains have these twin boundaries, but some of the grains also have the misindexing, such as in this purple grain we looked at earlier. So when we go to cleanup, typically what we will do is just run an auto cleanup process that will remove isolated single pixel errors and do a relatively low aggression data duplication to clean up most of the non-index points. But we can now use a pseudo-symmetry removal tool within our software to rotate those incorrectly indexed orientations. So I define the maximum area that we want to rotate. In this case, I'm setting it at 10 pixels. I remove those. You can see that those incorrectly indexed points have disappeared. But when we apply that to the main data set, you will also notice that the twin boundaries remain intact. So now we have a clean data set. That is represented over in the left-hand side in the information. So we're now 99.9% indexing, and it's telling us that these data have been modified. So what are the first things we would typically want to do with the EBSD data set is to measure the grain size. So we go to our grain size viewing mode. It will pre-calculate the grain size when we load up the data, and it will recalculate that once we've done the data cleaning. And there are many different parameters, which I'll show you in a moment. But we can filter the grain list based on phases. We can exclude grains below a certain size, and the default is to exclude those below 10 pixels, which is conforming to an ISO standard. But we can see already a problem with the grain size measurement. So here I'm picking out a number of twinned regions inside these large grains, and you can see those twinned regions have been picked out as individual grains, whereas they're in fact twin domains and they should be measured as part of the overall grain. So what we do is we specify that boundary relationship, and now it'll ignore those twins. And you can see as I'm picking out these large grains, it picks out the grains in their entirety and ignores the twin boundaries. We can look at any number of parameters. So the parameter list that we can actually measure with our grain detection is very long. It's including shape and size and orientation and pattern quality, for example. So we can see we've got an arithmetic mean here of 17 microns or an area weighted mean of 330 microns, and we see the AZTM grain size number. And we can export these data, the histogram, with all the relevant information can be exported. We can also look and see how many of the grains have been twinned. So we can see in this case 36% of the grains in this data set have been twinned, which constitutes 75% of the whole map area. And this would be broken down on phase by phase. And a new feature in AZtecCrystal allows us to start correlating between different parameters that are measured. So at the moment I've just got the standard parameter list, but I can see here, for example, where I'm highlighting with the mouse, that there is a reasonably strong correlation between the maximum orientation spread within a grain and the size, the equivalent circle diameter of those grains. So we can see bigger grains have a greater maximum orientation spread, which may reflect a greater degree of deformation inside these larger grains. So once we've measured our grain size, we can use that grain size information to plot a new map. So I'm going to plot a map that shows the pattern quality or the band contrast in the background, and then something known as the G-rod angle. This is the relative deviation from the average orientation of that grain as measured for each grain. So you can see it's already still highlighting the large grain that I'd picked out earlier on. I'm going to switch off the semi-transparency, and I'm actually going to change the colouring scheme to highlight the subtle changes a little bit more clearly. So I'm going to go to an extended colouring scheme. And in this central grain, you can see now very clearly all of the dislocation walls that are built up associated with the deformation of these large grains. So we can use many of these different grain-based components to show different features of our microstructure. I'm now just going to use a grain size component. I'm going to set that to the equivalent circle diameter. And we have, you know, a very clear grain size distribution here. We've got those large grains and we've got the very fine grain matrix. Now, it would be typical in a data set like this that we would want to separate those constituent parts, the large grains and the small grains, into different subsets, which we could then process independently. We could do that using the grain size histogram, but we have a new tool that was brought out in AZtecCrystal 2.0, which is a classification tool, which is a very effective way of separating our microstructure into different classes. So here I'm going to use the grain information. I'm going to stick with two classes and call the first one small. So I'm going to make those the small grains, and the second one I'm going to rename as large, so we can classify the large grains. And the way this works is it uses machine learning. So we train the system based on interactions with the data set. So I'm going to start off by training it to recognize large grains. So I click on one of those big grains, and you can see if I expand it on the right hand side, it's got a training area, region one. And I'm going to pick out a couple of these sort of smaller grains over in the matrix. So that's going to be our training for the large area. And now for the small matrix grains, I'm just going to define a rectangular region within the matrix grains. And as soon as I've done that, it will classify based on the information I've given it. And I could continue refining that classification. So you can see here the results down in the bottom right. 61.3% of the area is classed as the small grains, as the recrystallized matrix, and 38.7% as the large deformed relict grains. And we can put those classes into individual subsets, and you'll see on the left hand side in the data tree our data set is now split into the small and the large, and we can start to examine these separately. So the sort of thing we might want to do first of all is to have a look at the grain size within, for example, the matrix grains. And we can see here now we're selecting the matrix grains, and we see a much more typical normal grain distribution. The mean is not much different to the whole data set, but the area weighted mean is about 30 microns, so much smaller. And we can start looking at the texture, the crystallographic preferred orientation of these different regions in our microstructure. So I'm plotting the pole figure for the C-axis, the M-axis, and the A-axis for this trigonal quartz. I'm going to switch to a contour display, switch to discrete steps, and switch off the grade circles, and I'm going to go to a slightly different coloring scheme that highlights the orientations a little bit more clearly. And what you can see here is it's very clearly got a strong preferred orientation in the C-axis. But it's very important when we're looking at the texture information or the preferred orientation information that we get the right reference frame. So in this particular sample, the Y direction is the shear plane, the X direction is the normal to the shear plane. And we would normally plot the normal to the shear plane at the top of the pole figure, and the shear direction at the side of the pole figure. So I need to change the reference frame of my pole figure to approximate to those standards. So we change the projection plane over on the pole figure settings, and now that would be much more typical to what would be displayed in geological literature. And we can see what is called as a strong C-axis girdle in this particular pole figure, C-axis pole figure. If we were looking at metal samples, we may well use orientation distribution functions. And when we're doing that, it's very important that we get the right sample properties. And that would include the sample symmetry, which we typically set as orthorhombic, and the right relationship between our original sample coordinate system and the acquisition surface coordinate system. So these three angles that define the relationship between these two coordinate systems can be defined at the beginning of the data acquisition in our Aztec software. But in this particular case, because we're only looking at the pole figures, we can simply change the reference frame of the pole figure itself. We have many different settings on pole figures. There are different conventions. For example, in geological literature, it's more conventional to use the lower hemisphere. And we have a half width that defines how that pole figure is being contoured. The important thing here is that when comparing different data sets, we're using the same half width value. Now, because we've split the data into small and large grains, we've been just looking at the small grains, we can switch over to the large grains. And here we can see a very strong preferred orientation in the C-axis. And if we go to the point click mode, we can select points within these large grains and we can graphically see the three-dimensional orientation of that particular point. And we can see that marked in the pole figure. We go to one of the other large grains and we can see almost exactly the same orientation. And even the one up in the top left has pretty much the same C-axis and only a slight rotation of the M and the A axes. So it's clear from this analysis that these large grains have all originated from the same single very large grain, and they're gradually being distorted and recrystallized. We also have a lot of tools that allow us to look at boundary information, and boundaries tell us a lot about the microstructure. So here we're plotting for the small grains, we're plotting the distribution of disorientation angles. I'm starting off by showing the neighboring pair disorientations, and you can see a very strong peak at 60 degrees associated with all of those twinned grains, and we see a lesser peak at low angles, somewhere between sort of 6 degrees and downwards, associated with deformation. We can compare that with a random distribution, or we can compare that with randomly selected pairs of orientations. And so we can understand the significance of the peaks in the disorientation distribution. For example, are they just a function of the strong texture in the sample? If we switch over to the large grains, now we can see a much higher peak in the low angle boundaries, and they're extending all the way up to disorientations of 12 to 14 degrees. So it once again is indicative of a lot more deformation in these large grains. And we could look at disorientation axes, we could look at the boundary statistics, and we can interpret a lot of information from examination of the boundaries. So I'm now going to open up a different data set. This is a tempered martensitic steel sample, and it's a significantly smaller data set. It's only an area of about 50 microns by 50 microns, and it's a much more challenging sample to examine. So once again, this is data that I have opened before, so we have a few more displays, but the data have not been cleaned yet. So we can look at the phases, and we can see we've got some retained austenite in blue, and we've got a lot of carbides, Fe3C grains, shown in yellow. So this is quite a challenging sample to analyze, and it was collected at a slower speed. So on the left-hand side, you can see around about 220 patterns per second. It took about 25 minutes to collect this particular map. And the sample was not particularly stable, so there was some drift. So we can go back into the SEM image viewing mode, and we can use AZtecCrystal's distortion correction to correct for the drift that has occurred during the collection of this data set. And we can see as we're changing the map overlay that those yellow grains marking the carbides are displaced from the position of the carbides in the underlying forescatter image. So we're going to should do a very quick distortion correction, and this will make sure that our grain size and shape and boundary orientations are correct in the final data set. So I'm setting the transparency so I can see the position of those carbides in both the underlying image and in the EBSD phase map. And then I'm just adjusting the corners of the mapped area, and it will in real time correct the positions of the EBSD analysis points. So you can see this is a relatively rough and ready way of doing it. We have an extended correction mode which allows a more rigorous correction by correlating between different points in both the EBSD map and the SEM image. But this way works quite well if there's been relatively steady drift through through the collection of the data. And you can see just in 30 seconds or so, we have a much better correlation between those yellow carbides and their position in the underlying image. So we can now save that as a corrected data set, and it will create and resample the data with a modified step size and a different grid dimensions. So we can turn off the SEM image. You can see the step size has now dropped from 100 nanometers to 99.7 nanometers, and the grid dimensions have changed significantly as well. So I'm just going to do a very quick cleanup, an auto cleanup, and then one more removal of zero solutions. And what we're going to do here is use a new tool in AZtecCrystal to reconstruct the high temperature austenitic microstructure from which this martensitic microstructure has derived. And we do that by the system measuring the orientations of all the martensite variants, and then it will correlate between those orientations and compare them with an orientation relationship that is predefined, and it will reconstruct the original single parent microstructure. So we define the parent phase, the child phase, the starting orientation relationship, and then we train the system once again, a little bit like we did with the classify tool, to pick out a region. And I'm choosing a region that looks like it has come from a single parent austenite grain. And we can see in the pole figure down at the bottom that there's clearly a strong relationship between the ferrite, the BCC, and the austenite. So we apply that. I'm just going to increase the size of that training area to get slightly better orientation relationship refinement. We have a little trial area in the middle, and when I'm happy with that, we apply it to the whole data set. So you can see the results of the orientation relationship refinement. So it's gone about 2 degrees away from the starting Kirjamov-Sachs relationship. And now it's reconstructing the parent grains, and it's effectively gone back in time, or gone up in temperature. So this is how the microstructure might have looked if it was the original high temperature austenitic microstructure. And we can save that into a separate data set, and we can examine it as if it was data that we'd collected live at the microscope. So we can see those prior austenitic grains very nicely now. What we can also do is start looking at the boundaries, and we can, for example, see if we had special types of boundaries. So I'm going to add coincident site lattice boundaries into the map for the FCC phase, and we can see the presence of a lot of these twin boundaries. In fact, more than 50% of the high angle boundaries in this data set are twin boundaries. And we can correlate now between the original microstructure and the reconstructed parent microstructure. And this would allow us to understand the high temperature processing that has led to this particular microstructure. So the final data set I'm going to quickly look at is an additively manufactured titanium alloy. It's a Ti64. It's been polished so that the build direction is perpendicular to the surface of the sample. And this is a data set that I've looked at before, so it's reconstructing the same maps, and it's also pre-cleaned. So it tells me down in the data information at the left that it's already modified. This is a random colouring scheme for each grain, so we can see all of the alpha titanium lattice. This is the orientation map. We do have about 1% of retained beta titanium, but what I want to briefly show you is how we can use EBSD data to understand a bit more about the material properties, and in this case we're going to look at the elastic properties, the Young's modulus of this microstructure. So I'm going to load some elastic coefficients for the alpha titanium phase, and then I'm going to define a loading direction so that we're loading it parallel to the build direction. That's the Z direction, and the map here is showing the variation in Young's modulus on a grain by grain basis, ranging from blue, which is the lowest at about 100 gigapascals, up to the red grains, which are the highest Young's modulus, close at 150 gigapascals. And what's interesting here is when we look at the Young's modulus as plotted on a pole figure, just switch off the color gradient and the great circles, We can see a really strong clustering quite close to the Z direction, so close to the build direction. So the Young's modulus is significantly higher if we were loading parallel to the build direction than if we were loading parallel to the X or the Y direction in this particular map. So we can see how EBSD data can inform us about the strength and the performance of materials. So that concludes the live demonstration part of this tutorial. I hope that's given you a good impression of how we can process EBSD data, and more importantly, how we can use the tools that we have within our AZtecCrystal software to extract the key microstructural information from our EBSD datasets. So for those of you listening live, we will now proceed with a short question and answer session. But all that remains for me to say is thank you very much for all of you for listening in today. And remember to visit our website, where you'll find a lot more information about AZtecCrystal and our EBSD products.